Logic, School of Management. It is Symbol Logic.
Welcome to another episode of Business Sense. Business Sense is business plus essence. So it's the essence of business, actually. And this is presented by Logic School of Management. We call it as a entrepreneurial conversation in these COVID times. And today, we always say, we have a catch today. we have a person who is the most sought after person, who is the most revered person, respected person, and industrial par excellence, industrialist par excellence, actually. None other than Mr. Kochosif Chitrapalli. Sir, I will do a little introduction and then I'll start asking the question. Welcome to the show, sir, actually.
Okay. Please.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Okay. Mr. Kochosif Chitrapalli is actually a master's in physics, but he's now a master in multifaceted business. Okay. He, his company V-Guard is in light engineering products. His other group company, Wonderla, is in entertainment and theme park. He's into construction, that is Vigaland, construction and reality. He runs a charity that is called Chitrapalli Foundation. He also helps budding entrepreneurs and startup entrepreneurs through initiatives such as Vijayi Bhava. It is a very entrepreneurial family. Of course, Madam Sheila Kochosif, she is in the business of garments and doing extremely well. Children are also in the business. Okay. A person who thinks completely differently, and also a person who doesn't call a spade a shovel. Very straightforward person, and he tells what he feels, and he doesn't actually keep anything behind people. Sir, welcome to the show.
Welcome.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Sir, we are in COVID times. Okay. We never thought that we will go through these times just like this. 2 months back, if somebody said this is going to be the case, we would not have actually imagined. But slowly, the realization is dawning on to us. At one end, now more than 40 days of locking in has happened. Okay. So people are also becoming a little restless. Many countries where they business-wise, they were far ahead, they are also feeling restless. For example, Donald Trump, the president of America, says that I think we need to look after the economy better, that because people, it is now the question has come to between life and livelihood. What is your thought on this, sir, actually? Now, one end people say we should start the businesses, other end people say okay, we should close it and combine. So what is your thought on this, sir?
First of all, thank you, sir, for the elaborate introduction.
Thank you very much.
Regarding the COVID crisis, actually, I used to say there will be crisis situations on and off. That is the history. When we analyze history, definitely we had big challenges like, say, Second World War, or say, whether it is the Great Depression,
yes,
1930, or whether it is Spanish flu. So I believe I am lucky that I am able, I am surviving to see the COVID crisis also. Because some of my classmates, they passed away years back, or even last year also.
Yep.
So that way, I am lucky that I am witnessing in that crisis situation.
Yes.
What I believe, any crisis situation, there will be an end of it. There will be an end.
Okay.
Yeah. So. And again, every crisis situation, we can learn so many things, new things. Definitely, people will be searching for new opportunities. That is the usual practice. That is the order of the day. So,
yes,
we have to take it as a challenge. Then definitely, you can find out some opportunities in any crisis situation.
Okay.
That is my simple feeling. I am not a scientist. I am not a medical practitioner. I have no idea about how much time it will take. The only thing I can say, there will be an end. Whether
okay.
it is 3 months or whether it is 2 years, I don't know.
So it could be as low as about 3 months and as long as about 2 years. But 2 years could be a very tough proposition, isn't it, sir?
Yeah, definitely it will not be, because no people are the whole world is searching for a remedy, and there will be a solution.
Okay.
Mankind will come out with a vaccine, definitely, I'm sure, and I will see that vaccine, then only I will pass away.
Definitely, I think vaccine is not that far away. I'm told that maybe by about October, November, vaccines could be available for at least the front-end soldiers, that is, the health people can be vaccinated, and thereafter, others could also go through the vaccination. I understand, sir, actually, the vaccine which Oxford University, they have prepared, the manufacturing right of the vaccine is given to Serum Institute in Pune, which today has the largest capacity to manufacture vaccines in the world. 1.5 billion vaccines per annum, sir. 1,500 million vaccines a year, actually.
Yeah, so that way we Indians, we are lucky that whoever can invent the vaccine, finally it will be manufactured in India only, and part of the quantity we will get, don't worry.
So we are lucky that way. That's what you say. We are lucky that way.
Lucky.
Okay, right, sir. So now every nation is it, if you really look at it. Every nation is it. Nations which we thought are impenetrable, with the surplus funds and with the economic strength, etc., that they've had, even they have difficulties. Okay, now this being the case, is there any justification in some of the national heads saying that yes, this time has come for us to open up, get industries running and businesses going? You have any take on that, sir? Please, sir.
In fact, that way, I believe that India as a whole, we are lucky in the sense, when compared to many other nations, even in European countries or whether it is American countries or many other developed countries, we are much, much better, far better than many other developed countries.
Yes, sir.
Then another thing, in any case, there will be an advantage for another disadvantage. For example, now, many countries, they feel China cannot be trusted.
So yes,
definitely they will think about an alternative. So
yes,
as you said earlier regarding the serum, we can have a large manufacturing facility. Definitely India will be one of the opportunity. We will get an opportunity to bring more and more products. Earlier everything was concentrated in one particular country, say China, so
yes,
that definitely that there will be a diversification. Now any multinationals, they will think about setting up one more plant or one or two plants in different countries, and that way they will count India also.
That's okay, that's a very positive thought, but my question is, and I'm trying to basically do a little kindling, are we prepared to take this on? Because the infrastructure, the ease of doing business, the financial fund availability, etc., if you look at it, and the reform process that the government has been continuing for a long time, all this put together, do we have a good proposition to offer to worldwide business houses to come to settle their manufacturing setup in India, sir?
Of course, as a democratic country, we have our own difficulties, our own issues, that
yes,
is quite sure. Whereas China, they have almost an autocratic type of a administration.
Yes.
But by and large, I believe that depends on the leadership.
Yes.
If the leadership decides, definitely we will get an opportunity, I'm sure. And we people are capable. We are quite capable.
Okay.
And definitely a day will come. We also will rise to the occasion, and definitely more and more factories will come here, more and more investments will come here. That is my simple thought.
Good, sir. Good. Sir, I'm just referring to Kerala because you have long, long back, started this business to begin with the voltage stabilizer and thereafter light engineering products all the while. Now, what are the competencies of Kerala to become a manufacturing destination? Or what are the manufacturing that can be brought to Kerala, sir?
Kerala, we have our own limitations. We have very, very limited land.
Yes.
We cannot have a large extent of land. And
yes,
again, fully thickly populated, the land value is very high,
yes,
and we all of our population is almost educated. Every youngster immediately after 12th standard, he goes for a graduation. After graduation, he goes for a post graduation.
Yes.
So even in the lowest, still all of them are educated. So you cannot have a very ordinary type of manufacturing unit in Kerala. If it is a chemical industry or if it is a more labor-oriented industry, Kerala is not the right place to start. But if there is value addition, definitely, and if there is no pollution, definitely we can think about having industry in Kerala. But we also already proved that we have a number of small enterprises in connection with tourism. All of us know that slowly Kerala came up with a number of enterprises with the tourism related industries, and that way Kerala is an ideal place to develop more and more tourism related industry, I believe, than creating pollution by starting manufacturing units.
Yes. I was talking to E.M. Najib, who is an air travel enterprises chief, as well as to Mr. Josh Dubnik. The one input that they gave me, they were saying that tourism and travel is the first hit by COVID, and tourism and travel will be last to leave COVID, actually, because travel, etc. has to happen, tourism need to come. So they're very apprehensive, and they're saying that the only way is domestic tourism. So when I was checking board, they were saying it is all about Keralites visiting Kerala, or it's always all about Indians coming into Kerala so that we can actually look at it. But they feel that travel, etc. will be greatly constrained. Okay. Now that is on one side. As far as there was something else which I was always thinking in terms of, see, sir, in the beginning, if you really look at 70s and 80s, Kerala was one of those electronic manufacturing states in the country. If you know the Asia Times, Kerala, Keltron TV, etc., people were actually asking with recommendation to buy a TV from that side. And also we were going to discrete manufacturing like resistors, condensers, capacitors, etc. By, of course, governmental means, most of the companies at that time was belonging to the government. But from there, we have come to absolute nowhere as far as electronic manufacturing is concerned. Do you think Kerala still can have some competencies in electronic manufacturing?
I still remember thinking that no, Kerala is not that much ideal for large-scale manufacturing industry. Okay. We can go for any type of a service industry, whether it is IT or whether it is tourism or anything related with service industry, I believe. Kerala is an ideal place because, as we discussed earlier, the labor is not that cheap. Labor is not that cheap. For example, I have to confess, even though I am a Keralite, when we decided to start up the new production of our V-Guard, we put it in Sikkim. We took all the way to Sikkim. All the top. Why means there the labor is so cheap, and moreover, central government is giving a lot of concessions as far as backwardness. Kerala is not a backward area, so you can't expect any subsidy or another similar facility when compared to other states. So, but just now we were talking about tourism. I believe Kerala can have better hope in the sense once the vaccine is invented, then the problem is over. Then the problem is totally over.
Right.
Just life will be totally normally. It will be back to normal. No doubt about it. Then the best place in India is Kerala, because when compared to all other states in Kerala, all other states in India, Kerala is the only place we were able to contain the disease comparatively better than any other state. I believe Kerala, even others feel that Kerala is safe and Kerala is clean, Kerala is healthy, hygiene wise, and everything, I believe.
The HDI, the Human Development Indices in Kerala, some of them are at par with the Western world, like infant mortality, postpartum mortality, life expectancy, etc. If you look at it, we are on the higher side. No, but that is now resulting in people says Kerala is a place, we were trying to say that Kerala is a place good to live and work. But many people say Kerala is a place not to work. Kerala is a place good to live. So, do you think, what is your take on this? Somebody says Kerala is a good place to live, but live and work problem. Is there any truth in that?
No. When compared to say two decades or 3 decades, now things are far, far better.
Yes.
Even within Kerala, there are so many enterprises.
Yes.
They are flourishing well. So, the mindset has already changed.
Okay.
And compared to, say, 3 decades or 4 decades back.
Back.
We do agree that we have a lot of union issues. We have a lot of political issues.
Yes.
But I believe Kerala is a matured state. Matured
okay.
state. Now we have crossed the peak of the curve, and now we are more stable.
Yes.
Now, yeah, and I believe now, I think there will not be any much labor trouble inside the factories. No,
okay.
Not much. There may be some outside issues, political issues, that will be there anywhere in the country or
yes.
anywhere
yes.
in the world.
Yes.
And nobody is exempted. Yeah.
Okay.
I believe this may give a better chance for Kerala to be highlighted when compared to the whole India, and again
okay.
when compared to the whole other countries.
Yes, yes. Oh, that's it. So we have a imminent challenge that people are looking at is the return of the Gulf, people who are in the Gulf. It is estimated that we have more than about 25 lakhs people working in GCC nations, you know, across the Gulf. Some of them are actually work at the lower end, and some of them may be at the higher end, and predominantly people are at the lower end. And there also the jobs are drying up, and the economy is also challenging, and you have seen the oil prices hitting the bottom. All this put together, and also COVID diseases, people are suffering. Many people, I understand that Norca has had more than about 2 lakh people registered to come back. The non-resident affairs that the department. So all this put together, do you think the returning of the Gulf employees or people, Malayalis who had gone to Gulf, is it going to create a social problem, or the state will be in a position to accommodate them in entrepreneurship and services?
Of course, I believe maybe 10 to 20% or even 30% people may come back, suppose.
Okay.
Even then, the same way, you know, all of us know that, you know, we are happy with the number of North Indian workers.
Yes.
And some of the workers are going back to their
yes.
own states. So
yeah.
Definitely, there will be a balancing activity going on. And I believe all these people coming back from Gulf countries, they are much experienced.
Very experienced.
Very
yes.
experienced. So that is an opportunity. That is an opportunity to invest in Kerala, especially for some multinationals, you know. That is my personal thinking. I am always optimistic for anything. Even in any crisis situation, I am always optimistic. That
okay.
much I can say. So,
yeah.
whatever questions you ask, I will land up in with an optimism.
Yeah, I understand. That's a very that's a great thing, because particularly Malayalis, we are very critical. If you really look at our
yeah.
media, our rulers, our denizens, our bureaucrats, everybody is very critical. And I mean, lots of us also are very critical. So I think it is very important for somebody's positivity to be around, and that way I think you are spearheading that movement of being positive or optimistic. Very important.
No, if you have that positive thinking attitude,
yes,
definitely you will find an opportunity.
Yes,
there are opportunities flying around among within us or in and around us.
Yes,
but it's up to you to decide how to capture it. So,
yes.
if you have a pessimistic attitude, definitely we cannot. That's the sad part. Yeah.
Okay.
An optimist, one more. An optimist will find an opportunity in every difficulty. At the
that
same
right.
time, a pessimist will find a difficulty in every opportunity.
Oh, that's great. It has come out of your mouth. I was actually warning that it should come out of your mouth, because I have heard it several times. Many places, personally, I have gone and said, quoting you, saying that, you know, I have heard Coach Joseph speaking like this, that, you know, an optimist will find an opportunity even in the difficulty, and the other thing being vice versa. You're very right. I think absolutely important. But the challenge is our system does not give that opportunity, that ambience, you know, for that opportunistic, optimistic thinking. That's a challenge. So that's why there are very limited people like you, you know, in spite of the fact that the difficulties that you have undergone, still thinks very optimistically. What do you think, sir, actually?
No, not only me alone. You know, yeah. There are a number of people who are successful within Kerala resources.
Yes.
They made a lot of money within Kerala. There are a number of people, not only me or we got.
Yes.
In my case, I have to confess that I encashed another crisis situation. That means I encashed the incapability of electricity department. That means voltage fluctuation.
Yeah. As a business opportunity.
as a business opportunity. How can I complain about the difficulties within Kerala? Even within Kerala, we can find out opportunities. That is my thinking.
Absolutely. Normally, you know, like when I take the classes on entrepreneurship in IIM, you know, there were three areas we always highlight, telling that, you know, one is a problem solution, solving problem for the people. The other is finding gaps. And the third is saying that what are the trends that is there in the market and following the trends. You know, there are three, four ways of entrepreneurship flourishing, and there are the idea gap. But I think, you know, in those days, 30, 40 years back, you know, you looking at that opportunity, because in this state at that point in time, people were not thinking of private enterprises. You must have understood. People were thinking of everything being the government. The state controls the destiny of the people. And that's the way of thinking that you have. And the startup business at that time, and the business to flourish and coming to this stage, you know, what is that magic band that you played for your business to come up like this, actually?
No, that way, I never did any magic. I believe it was a very gradual, steady, slow growth. And I used to say that it took 43 years for me to reach up to this level.
Okay.
Even Dhirubhai Ambani started business after starting. I started in 1977, whereas Reliance started in 1983 only. Yeah.
Yes.
So mine was very slow and steady, but steady growth.
That is right.
But again, my attitude is nothing but capture the opportunities.
Yes.
Just
yes.
Grab the opportunity.
Grab the opportunity.
Grab the opportunity. So started with stabilizers, then immediately I switched over to other products, then added a number of products, and then after 20 years, even totally diversified into amusement park.
Yes.
Yeah. So I believe opportunities are here, are everywhere.
No, but even that is something very interesting, in the sense that I had always seen people who are in business, they try to go for related diversification, and you are the one who had actually looked at very unrelated diversification. Again, any thoughts on that? Why did you think in those lines? Is it because you think differently?
There are two reasons, and in fact, you know, by that time, I have completed around 20 years. Okay. Since I started VGAT.
Yes.
Now, by that time, I was able to develop a number of my own young managers, young engineers,
yes,
young executives. And looking back, they are doing extremely well.
Okay.
Extremely well means better than me. I used to say better. Because I used to say I was only an average student in school as well as in college. If I can perform this much, definitely all my managers can perform better than me. That is my thinking.
Yeah.
And I used to give them, I used to empower them. I used to give them opportunities. I used to give them responsibilities. And I was waiting, and they used to achieve the targets. They were able to perform well. And after 20 years, I thought, okay, even in my absence, VGAT is running reasonably well.
Yeah.
So why can't I totally diversify into totally a different area?
Yes.
So in that situation only, you know, when we travel abroad for holidays, you know, that time kids were quite young, school going kids.
Yeah.
For their sake, I used to take them amusement parks like Disneyland or Universal Studio.
Yes.
I thought, why can't I have a smaller version of the
those studio.
Disneyland in Kochi. That was a small beginning. Actually, we invested only 22 crores that time.
Right.
Anyway, that time for me, 22 crores is quite big for me.
At that time, yes.
Yeah. And again, even my auditors, my consultants, many my advocates, everybody discouraged me. So investing huge amount within Kerala, within Kerala, and employing too many number of people within Kerala. But somehow I had a blind belief there will be a demand, there is a requirement. So that was the beginning of amusement park Wonderla.
Yes. Okay. I have another question, because you know, you may, because you take everything so lightly, even the answers are so light, you'll tell actually. But the fact is, I had seen your employees, most of the people who work with you, most of them come from ground zero. They also came from the scratch. They learned, and but the empowerment that you gave them and the positive ambience that you provided them actually made them do wonders. So I am yet to see organizations of this nature where even if, you know, empowerment, etc. happened, it hasn't gone like this. So what is the secret? I mean, is it that, you know, you give them the positivity and the embolden them, or what is it that make them do better than best?
There is no secret, nothing, nothing to hide. No, my again, I have to repeat, I gave opportunities for young executives that time, young engineers that time, young accountants that time, and I empowered them. I encouraged them to attend some say, training programs, evening classes. They parallelly developed themselves.
Okay.
And some of them are extremely doing well.
So, really? Yes.
Usually I used to say I am a very lazy person. Whatever, whatever possible, I used to delegate to somebody else.
Yes.
If possible. Yes. Yeah. I used to delegate. Yeah. So I gave more and more responsibilities to them, and slowly I entered into other field. That was a gradual process, and that way I am successful. I am still,
very
I'm
good.
Happy, and I am proud that we have a set of managers who. Some of them are now vice presidents at the age of, say, 58, 57, who started their career, first job in VGuard as a junior executive in marketing or in the as a junior engineer in production.
Yes.
Now they are sitting in the chair of vice president of VGuard group.
That's great. I think it's particularly in this age, you know, where people hop in from companies to companies and jobs to job. You still have people who are joined at junior executive level and they are now at the level of decision makers and vice president and things like that. So I also would like to take a little attention on to Vijay Bhava, an initiative which was started about close to about 6-7 years back. So what was the thought behind Vijay Bhava? What did you want to do at that time, sir?
Around 6 years back, and actually myself and my good friend Satyanarayanan, of Verma and Verma, leading chartered accountant. So we were discussing, and he used to compel me, okay, you must start a facility for youngsters, young entrepreneurs. By that time, we had this Chitlapalli Foundation.
Yes.
So why can't you have a branch of Chitlapalli Foundation? Some facility to empower small scale industries. That again, small scale industries below poverty. That means some of them are limping, who are really limping.
Yes.
So myself and Satyan designed 4 days course.
Yes.
Four days, not continuous.
Yes.
Every week, 1 day.
Yes.
That means 4 weeks.
4 weeks,
but,
yes.
4 weeks, but only 4 days. Yeah.
I understand.
But,
yes.
But what we do, we invite a number of successful entrepreneurs.
Yes.
And give them an opportunity to talk with them.
Yes.
In between, we invite the professionals also.
Yes.
Let them interact with them.
Okay.
Not on a lecture basis, more of
experience sharing.
Yeah, interactive basis, question answer, interactive sessions.
Yes.
So that clicked well. We started one course, and after 4 months, one more batch, then another batch, then now, I think around there are 500 people, more than that.
Yes, I remember, because last Vijay Bhava alumni meeting that I went, my goodness, it was a full house session at Hyatt Hotel. Yes.
Yeah, there again, my idea was just to empower them, motivate them. My thoughts, like say positive thinking, you know, the advantage of delegating things, the advantage of self-development. For example, I did number of training programs and evening courses to improve my skills.
Yes.
And because I was born and brought up in a village.
Yes.
In a remote area. And I am a 90-50 model, very old one, 50 model. Yeah. So that time there was no electricity in my village.
Yes.
Electricity came to my village only when I was studying third standard.
Okay.
Third standard.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah. Till that period, I was doing my homework under this kerosene lamps.
Kerosene lamps. Yeah. Yes.
Yeah. And the first radio bought to my house was when I was studying in seventh standard.
Absolutely, that was the, I can imagine.
That was the limited facilities. You know,
yes.
Roads were not tar.
Yes.
Only one or two buses. That's
yes.
all. So, if I can do this much, everybody can do much more than what I can do. That is my simple thought. I used to convey that, and I used to empower them. That's all.
Yeah. So I think you know, it's always, you know, optimism, smile, laughter, good thinking, etc. are very contagious. And coming from you, you know, it is not a corona, but definitely it is optimism. You know, I think many people, I talk to lots of them who had been either part of the Vijay Bhava or who had an opportunity to meet you and talk to you, etc. And they carry back that sense of, you know, that positivity. Yes, I can. That sort of a feeling that they carry back. I think that's a tremendous thing. So, looking at the country today, we see lots of enterprises coming up, but at another end, you know, we have banking having NBA trouble. Of course, COVID is going to create challenges to us, etc. And there had been some school of thought telling that reforms are not happening at the pace at which it should have happened. That is another school of thought. And also some level of a complaint about, you know, demonetization and thereafter the tax raj, etc. happening had not been very good. Do you think our country is now, after going through all these experiences, now do you think our country will basically get into a good metamorphosis to be a better manufacturing hub for the world as well as a better service hub for the world?
My thinking definitely. Now, when we introduced this, you know, demonetization, everybody thought that will be a good idea to wipe out the
black money,
the black money, but unfortunately that never happened. Anyway,
yes.
I still believe the GST.
Yes.
The idea of GST is extremely good.
Good.
Now we have a standard pattern all over the country.
Yes.
We have different production units in different states. So
yes.
we had that difficulty earlier. No
tax difficulty. Yes.
Different tax structure. Then number of checkposts, too many issues. So now it looks like as a single one country.
Integrated, tax integrated.
So with all these reasons, with all these steps, I believe India is more matured. And
okay.
any multinational, if they are ready to invest in Kerala, in India, definitely, you know, when compared to the previous decades. Things are far, far better. Far, far better. All of us may have different political different
understanding and affiliations.
That is different. But by and large, we are on a growing path. We Indians. Our country is definitely on a growth trajectory. That is my feeling.
Okay. I had lately seeing you like going a little extended travel in Japan and places like that. So how do you want to spend your time from now on? I mean, what is that you're planning for yourself? You know, having built up companies, going public, everything is now there in places and there are people to look after. All the systems are in place. So what is that you're planning for yourself in coming time?
I myself used to analyze myself and I used to say, okay, you are getting old, no? definitely. So, just for your information, for the last 5 years, I never ever involved in the activities of V-Guard or Wonderla.
My goodness, that is great. Professionally managed, actually. Yes, okay.
Not at all. Just yes. Attending the board meetings.
Board meetings.
Nothing more than that.
Yes.
Even till March 31st, I was the chairman. Now, from April 1st onwards, I am just chairman.
Board member.
Of course, I like traveling. I used to. But you know, as you know, for the last five
COVID
years,
did not have it.
It allowed me to travel.
Sir, we have been speaking for close to about 35 minutes. Okay. Just flowing, actually. It was just flowing. So I would end by asking the most final question. So what is your advice to young entrepreneurs, sir? What is your advice to young entrepreneurs?
I used to say to young entrepreneurs, if you are looking for a long-term success, that quality consciousness and straightforward attitude must be there.
Okay.
There is no shortcut. Unfortunately, there is no shortcut for a long-term success.
Yes.
If you are searching for short-term success, definitely there may be so many opportunities.
Yes.
But if you want a long-term success, definitely you must be quality conscious. You must be straightforward.
Yes.
You must keep some ethical standards.
Yes, absolutely.
Values and ethical standards that may vary from people to people, but
yes,
by and large, you have to be strict to that. Otherwise, we can see a number of failures mainly because of that they deviated from their track and finally collapsed like a pack of cards. That is the history. That is the usual pattern.
Yes.
And some of them are ending their life. You know,
ending their life is a
fashion, I believe. Yeah.
That's so bad, actually.
So, I always talk about quality consciousness and straightforward attitude.
Ethical values, yes.
That's all.
Right, sir. So, thank you very much. Thank you very much. It has been a wonderful interview. I am very privileged to have talked to you because the first time I'm actually doing a formal interview. I have had several talks and chats with you many number of times, but the first time I'm doing a formal level of an interview of you. I have really enjoyed doing it. I hope you also have enjoyed it.
Yes, I also enjoyed because as you said, we had several forums. We met in several occasions, but
yes,
this is the first time. As a one-to-one interaction.
One-to-one interaction.
Yeah. You said only 10 to 15 minutes, but it went up to 30 minutes. Okay.
Yes, great. Great, sir. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
I wish you all the good times, and I'm sure I wish you more health and more prosperity and more time all for yourself. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, sir.
Yes.
Good. Bye.
Thank you.
Bye.
Bye. Bye. Bye. Bye. Bye. Bye.